Hi, this is Abraham El Jaguar, a professional game master.
For me, success at the table involves walking away feeling like the players were engaged and having fun.
TTRPG hobbyists appear to have a higher percentage of folks on the autism spectrum.
Now, and so it begins.
Hey, can someone tell Shauner to shut the fuck up? No one cares what you think.
Because we want to bring, you know, talent to you guys. We want to bring
all the geeky wisdom that's provided by so many different sources here on YouTube or anywhere else online, or even with friends that you play with at the table.
By the way, also, we're talking about gaming stuff. Not going to get weird about anything else. So if you're going to come in and talk, you're going to talk about whatever conversation is going on at that time, or you're going to have a gaming topic to talk about. I don't want you just sitting here like as in, look at me, I'm on a stream.
I am an EMT. I am not going to go straight into that burning whatever the fire until it's been cleared up a little bit. So, you know what? Just going to play with luck and a little bit of, you know, with people and, you know, that guy looks like he needs a little bit of a bonus buff, you know. Just quietly help make them a little better, subtly, as though try not really to attract too much attention, just to make people think that they're better than they are, and just contently do my job and make other people do theirs better.
Okay, what does that mean in game terms?
I'm giving them the ability to, if they have to make any kind of a roll.
Who is them?
The NPCs who are around me, the firefighters and these rescue people who are doing their jobs.
See how much more helpful it is when you tell me who you're helping?
Part of the scene. I am being a subtle doctor, being a doctor, helping people. I am just waiting for, I am not a guy with laser cannons and fireballs and blaster, pistol, fire bullshit. I just do my job.
Today's topic is actually going to be talking about opening up the game even wider for people who are neurodivergent on the spectrum. How do we invite them to the table to engage and have a bunch of fun, learn and grow from that?
And then it came with two D percentile dice, which at the time, again, were D20s. So we're going to get into that later. But D10s, for those of you who don't know, they don't come around for a while. Okay, and I did talk about this on my last game, but essentially these were numbered 1 through 9, and there was a dark colored die and like a white colored die. Okay, and so you used one for the tens and one for the ones, and so you rolled them. So if you rolled 00 on the tens die, and then you rolled a 3, that was 3%, and if you rolled a 30 on the tens die, or a 3 in this case, because it's numbered. They didn't have double zero. So it's numbered 0 to 9. So if you rolled a 0 on the tens die and a 3 on the ones die, that was your 3%. If you rolled a 3 on the tens die and a 0 on the ones die, that's 30%. So the one thing that always trips people up is that if you rolled 0, 0, that's not 0%, it's 100%. And the reason it's 100% is because you're calculating a number from 1 to 100. You're not calculating a number from 0 to 99. So there's no 0. Unless you're playing a system that is calculating numbers from 0 to 99%. It's just not common, right? Most games are generating a number from 1 to 100. So the double 0 is 100%. That's just how dice like this works. And it actually tells you that in the game here. Okay, so I don't have the original dice that came in this because I bought, so the short version is I bought this box with just the rule book.
And right as you approach the tree, the leaves are already swaying in the wind a little bit as you approach the tree. And Althea, you were the first to notice because you come up to the tree and you're just kind of like pressing up against the trunk to see if there's anything.
That tickles.
And some branches move away, and you see that the tree has a beautiful, wizened face right there in the front, smiling at you. Oh, that tickles me.
Gaspar's beard is almost as glorious as yours.
Indeed.
Oh,
yes. My dear.
You flatter me.
One of the biggest worries for a game master running a hex crawl campaign is that your players will struggle to know what to do.
What's your problem?
Well, sir, horned one, we are traveling in search of sellswords, warriors who might help our village, and in exchange, I'm sure we could find some of this Wa'id of which you speak.
Oh, then you don't want me. I'm just a scientist with an incredible glove for jerking people off.
What's up, nerds? Just taking a leisurely late afternoon stroll. Pondering things that we ponder when we walk. Tossing out some pearls of wisdom in regards to GM tips, right? Not that I am any way, shape, or form categorically perfect as a DM, but I think I've picked up a thing or two over the past 40 some odd years.
Out on their forum, the subsector by subsector, and I got about 3 or 4 of those, and then talked to some other people, and then decided I would approach Matthew about it, and he said, yeah, sure, go ahead, do the book. You need to do 2 sectors. You got to do Vanguard Reaches, too. And that one was a bigger mess. I mean, there's a whole subsector of SS Worlds in the, literally, SS Division. So it was a whole subsector from Paranoia Press, so that needed to be gutted. That and Buxom World? Is that what we're going to call that? So, I mean, there was a lot of stuff that just had to go.
Was that the planet of the Amazon women?
I don't know.
Yeah.
There was a Thieves World, too, which probably was just stolen straight from Thieves
Robert
World.
Aspirin, stuck yeah.
In there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly, and just dropped in there. So that might have been good enough for 1980, but it certainly wasn't good enough for 2020.
Shawner is with us. I believe it's a first-time visit, pointing out there's actually a player shortage. I don't know about that.
What are the rules for D&D? So I asked some of my friends to join me so we could discuss a little bit. And believe it or not, D&D is probably one of the easiest things to actually get started in, because all you need is your imagination.
Nebula weeps his hands, raising power around him. Behold the power of the mind. Purple and blue colors swirl about his head. Behold, I now unleash my full power and shoots out a psionic bolt at the closest orc. Impacting it in the chest. Inflicting terrible damage. But the orc remains standing.
While no D&D is better than bad D&D, pretty good D&D is better than no D&D.
Brotherhood's tiny old history, a garden of pure ideology, where each worker may bloom, secure from the pests of a contradictory.
I decided to look on the internet and watch about, you know, 1,000 hours of YouTube content of people playing RPGs, explaining RPGs, talking about mechanics, designing them, and so on. It turns out that there is a group of people on the internet that had already had the idea that I had had. In fact, it's very old. It's been around forever and had already had lots of thoughts on the matter and already had a lexicon to go with it and already had conventions to go with it. So this got me really excited. Because I found some people who were thinking the same way I was when it came to role-playing games. And that was, I didn't want to play a board game in my RPG. Board games are fine, okay, but role-playing games are the worst kind of board games. And role-playing games with board games in them are the worst kind of role-playing games. I'm on the internet now, on YouTube, and I've decided to try and connect with people who have the same sort of philosophy that I do when it comes to TTRPGs. And I'm looking forward to continuing to develop my game and continue to test and learn and hopefully play as a player to learn some things as well.
You are watching the Shauna channel, host of Traveler, Python, CG, Skyrim, and Bikini videos.
Hey, this is Sean. Misfits did a video on playing online, you know, tabletop RPGs. She's got pros and cons about it.
Hello, Misfits, and welcome. In today's video, we are talking about the pros and cons to playing D&D online. Now, some of you might know this, but some of you might not. That is pretty much the only way I play the game these days. I started in person, like a lot of people do, but as lives change, as me and my friends grew up and were seeking jobs that were going to take us to different cities or getting ready for grad school, it seemed pretty evident that we were not going to stay in the same town and be able to play in person. So I took it upon myself to figure out how we could keep the group together despite not being in the same city. And that's how I stumbled upon Roll20 and kind of got into this world of playing D&D online. What's crazy is this was all happening before the pandemic, before the plague, took the world by storm.
When did ICQ come out? Or Pow Wow? Active Worlds? What's another game? I guess I've been doing this since the 90s. Cameras got really good. Around 2002, 2003. I mean, good as far as, you know, standard. Instead of HD, there was SD.
My group actually started playing online in 2019. Now it's been, 5 years of us playing online and me DMing an online game, and I've learned quite a bit about the process, and I've watched how things have changed, and some for the better and some for the worse, as more and more people discovered this method of playing the game. And even though I sometimes feel like I do know what I'm doing, I am still learning new things every single day. But I wanted to talk with you guys about what I consider to be the major pros and cons of playing online. Some people might think that it is completely inferior in every way, and I don't necessarily think that that is true. There are definitely some pros to playing online. So let's get into this list. Let's talk about that. Before we get any further, I do want to talk to you guys about Sci-Fire. So Sci-Fire is the sister company of Books Please, and it is dedicated to offering people an extensive collection of books from a variety of genres. They sell manga, fantasy, science fiction, gaming books, and...
Oh, okay. When I read that, I thought Cypher. Sci-Fire. Okay.
And much, much more. They have graciously asked me to be an affiliate, meaning that if you use the code MISFIT at checkout, you can get 5% off your purchase. On top of this discount, Sci-Fire is already trying...
Okay. When does the video start?
Starfinder, The Call of Cthulhu, and much more. So be sure to go look through their website, and don't forget to use the code MISFIT at checkout. All right, so let's start out with a nice pro before we get into some of the undesirable aspects of online play. So,
Hey, pro, what would be a pro for online? You can find better players. That's a pro. I went to a game store yesterday. It was the worst group of players I've ever seen in my entire life. The guy who runs the store, he looked like he wanted to put a bullet in his mouth. He did not want to be there. He's probably dreading when his rent goes up again. What games will be available that people will want to buy? You know, you clear off the shelves and you find out that Warhammer 40K is not what the fans want to buy. And you cleared out the stuff they would want to buy still. Because you're hoping the new stuff would be, you know, the new stuff. Now what do you do? Because I don't think you can return the stuff if you buy it. I think you're stuck. If no one buys your stuff, I think you're stuck with it. Like D&D, you're stuck with it. And those kinds of stores, those kinds of environments attract certain kinds of players, customers into your store who are clueless about any of this stuff. They're not in reality. They don't live in reality. They come in your store, you know, to use your bathroom mostly because they live outside. What are you going to do?
Major pro to playing TTRPGs online is that you aren't limited to finding people in your area. So one of the hardest things about getting a group together is just the act of getting a group together. But
safety, also, that's another thing. Let's say you did know people locally that could come to the game store and you could have a game session at the store. They're going to ask, what neighborhood is this game store in? And when you tell them, they're like, they just hang up on you. You hear dial tone.
With the way online games have evolved, it's super easy to just pop into like a forum or a Discord or a Facebook group or just Roll20's website and just find a game that you can join. It's so, so, so easy, and you're not limited to having to find people in your area. You could be playing with people down the street or on the other side of the world.
Here's the thing. You don't have to be near the person to play the game. You can just play online. Now, let's say you want to learn ballroom dancing. You can't do that online. You know, octagon cage fighting online. You can't do that online. You have to go to the cage. You have to go to the swingerio. And you're going to have to make eye contact. And you're going to have to dance or have some fancy fighting moves in real life with someone else. With people watching you and telling you, you're doing it wrong. You can't do square dancing by yourself or ballroom dancing. So I'm amazed. I'll be somewhere and I hear, you know, Disco Inferno playing really loud. And I'm thinking, what is that, a bar? And I look in the window and it's a bunch of couples, maybe 100 people crammed up in some dance room with mirrors everywhere. Maybe it was a gym at one time, but now it's a dance room. I was thinking, you can't do that online. Yeah. I think everyone in there was a conceal carry because that neighborhood is rough.
And that is truly remarkable. But a major con to playing D&D online is that you are at the mercy of the other player's equipment. Bad microphones, crappy internet.
Oh, I like how she said crappy. Crappy. So I'm not the only one. Yeah, social contract. I wrote a book about it. There's some important items that you want. You want someone with a decent microphone, camera. a fast computer, fast internet. Otherwise, it's going to be horrific. Horrific. That one player who's on dial-up still.
Net, cheap cameras, you name it. All it takes is one of these things to go wrong for the session to kind of feel a little bit ruined. And for you to lose that player for that session, or even longer, depending on what the situation is. From a DM's perspective, this sucks.
Now, you don't have to spend a whole lot of money for a mic. You know, a good mic is what? What's a good mic these days? $100? $120? You can get the fancy ones with the boom and everything. You can get the fancy cameras that are like $400 and up, which are nice. But to just be in a game session, game session, you know, an $80 camera. You're going to need a tripod for your camera, so get one of those too. Sometimes the cameras come with one. Preferably something that can do 1080. You want something that can do 1080. You never know. You might need it. Some people have 720, but 720 is sort of going down the wayside.
I can't count the number of times like somebody's internet like crapped out and we lost that player. And sometimes it happens at an okay time when their character's not really in the middle of roleplay. And sometimes it happens at an incredibly crucial time. And
fighting the monster at the end, critical hits everywhere, critical fails everywhere, everyone's in panic mode, and then someone's in mid-sentence, someone just disappears, like they're gone.
It just flat out sucks. This is especially difficult when you're trying to, you know, like record your game.
Yeah, don't come on the stream with your phone. You need a computer. In reality, you need a computer for this stuff. Don't come on there with the phone or the iPad. And as your battery dies, you start sounding like a robot.
And put them up on your own YouTube channel. So, this is the worst thing. And you don't really have control over the other player's equipment, you know? If somebody comes in and they have really bad audio, you can't just be like, go buy a nice mic. Like, that doesn't really work out. And, you know, sometimes people have massive internet outages and you have no control over that. And sometimes it means, you know, having to pause the game for a while. Sometimes it means losing a player for the rest of the session. It sucks. And there's really no, like, fix to this. And this is just something you're going to have to work around.
And echo. Make sure you don't have echo when you come into the session. Everyone should be wearing earbuds or headphones or something.
I guess all things considered, if we're comparing this to in-person play, it's not that different from like somebody having an emergency and having to leave, or, you know, a last minute thing pops up and they can't come to the game. I guess it could be kind of similar to that, but it's just not fun. It just kind of sucks every single time. Major pro to playing online is no commuting or lugging around maps and minis. For the most part, you're probably just at home, like I am right now. You're just sitting at your own desk, and so if you've been playing for hours and hours and hours, and it's late into the night, and you log off, you're probably just mere steps away from your own bed, and you don't have to, like, get in a car and drive.
Pizza. Or, if no pizza, you're going to your car to get pizza. What was the other thing? I forgot what she's talking about already. I'm thinking ahead.
Hours and it's late into the night, and you log off. For the most part, you're probably in town.
Oh, so you want to vet your players, right? Vet your players. Find out if they have good microphone, good internet, good camera. Do a practice session. Hang out with them for an hour. See how the connection lasts. You know, some people's internet goes haywire if they're on you know, dish, and there's a cloudy day, that's the end of their internet. Or when the sun begins to go down, that's the end of their internet. It's like they're using, you know, FM frequency, where they call those things the point-to-point radio internet. Yeah, those things.
And go home. And you don't have to, you know, roll up the battle map and put all your minis in a box and put all your dice away and lug all of that. You're just...
Oh, if I go somewhere, if I go to someone's house, I'll have a book, but it's in the car. I'm not going to bring the book with me. It'll stay in the car. I'll bring my dice. I have a die bag or just the dice in my pocket. That's it. And my character sheet. I don't do minis. Nope. Don't do the board thing. Nope.
Just home. And you don't have to do any of that stuff. And that's pretty nice. Honestly, when ye old plague kind of put a pause in the world.
Yeah, I think if you're still playing a board game with minis, you know, pogs and stuff like that, you're already the player with baggage. And then if you're going to go online, guess what? You're going to try to emulate that online. You're going to try to organize that chaos online. That's just more baggage. Roleplay, you don't need any of that for roleplay.
You know, that was kind of the nice thing, I guess, about online classes. Because I was in grad school through the majority of the really bad part of the pandemic. And, you know, you can just sort of roll out of bed and just make sure that you look presentable from, like, the waist up. And nobody's going to be the wiser. And the second class is over, you can roll back into bed. It was kind of nice. And, you know, I know people that did work like that as well. I mean, I was giving voice lessons and I was kind of doing the same thing. So not having to commute, always a perk, in my opinion. So this is like a mix of a pro and a con. I want to talk about crosstalk and, you know, being able to mute yourself and that sort of aspect of online play. I think most of us remember when we were adjusting to...
Make sure the people you invite to your game are self-aware. So they know to mute when they have to cuss out someone in the family behind them. Or turn their camera off so you don't see, I don't know, what would it be? What would it be? See, I have my camera facing the wall behind me. So the chance of, I don't know, what would people see with the cameras facing? Like, most people have their camera facing away from the wall. So it films their entire living room. You know, their entire, if they have an open house design, you see the whole entire house from their one camera. So you're seeing people going in and out of the house. People throwing their backpacks on the floor. Eating, watching the television. Oh, that's it. Watching the television. That used to annoy me so much when someone's in the game. They're in the living room with their computers up against the wall. And their camera shows, you know, at Aunt Bessie or whoever is watching, you know, in the Lazy Boy watching some big-ass TV screen. And you can hear the movie. And it's like the guy is like, hold on, let me mute my mic for phone. Let me turn off my camera. You know that? Don't have your camera facing your entire room. Unless you're DM Lair and you have like cat and dog cams or something in the house. I don't know what his situation is, but he has no furniture in his house. It's kind of weird.
A pandemic life and a life of online meetings and online classes and all sorts of things like that, that talking over each other online sucks. It makes it impossible to focus on anything, and it's basically...
Yeah, you got to be patient. You got to talk when everyone else is done talking. That's why I think if you roleplay, there's less talking. If everyone's asking Mother May I questions, out of character stuff constantly, telling jokes constantly, I guess there's going to be a whole lot of crosstalk.
You just can't do it. It happens a lot in D&D. It's like when two people over here are having a conversation while the DM is having a conversation with somebody else. And
that should not be happening. Unless it's like, what do they call it? It's the meet and greet or the after show. But during the game, no, that should not be happening during the game.
There's multiple things happening at the same time. That does not work online. You have to mute yourself when you are not in the spotlight and having your roleplay moment, pretty much. Otherwise, it's incredibly distracting and horrible and hard to focus. So crosstalk basically just gets eliminated in online play. Everybody learns pretty quickly that they need to mute when they aren't talking, and that's great. It's fantastic. It's way easier to, like, be a more courteous player and allow different people to take the spotlight and know when to step up and be that person and when to bow out. I feel like my table especially have become just so, like, polite and gracious to each other because they've had to adapt to this style of play. And crosstalk does.
I'm curious, how long does that take? How long does it take a human being? I don't know, roughly what? 18 to 38 years of age? How long does it take them to acclimate themselves to the online arena of death, as it were? Is it soon, quick? It takes years? Is it a question of just learning the technology, how to use Windows or Macintosh properly? Or, heaven forbid, they're using Linux, as some people call it. I don't know, Skype? People do face-to-face on their phones, right? They should have an idea of how, video conferencing. They should have an idea of how that works if they've been using a phone for the last 5 or 6 years with decent internet connection.
This kind of continue to exist in online games, but it can exist in the form of talking in a chat. Like, they can have their side conversations in chat and not distract the people that are sort of acting in the scene, so to speak. So that's also a nice thing.
And if you are using your phone for whatever reason, put it in portrait mode, please. No, I'm joking. Anyone who got this far in the video, say what mode the phone should be in when you're using it as a webcam.
About this online play. However, when everybody is muted and you're the DM and you tell a funny joke or, you know, throw in a massive twist and drop some, like, crazy bomb in terms of, like, story and plot, and everybody's muted, it's just dead silence, and it's crickets, and it kind of sucks. It feels like you're doing stand-up and you told a joke and it didn't land, you know? And I hate it. It feels like you're unable to engage with your audience, and that is, like, one of my least...
How's that work? My players... they're not in situations where they have to mute themselves. They have a separate room they go to in the house. It's pretty soundproof-ish. Me, I live near Hell Centro. Hell Centro. Is that in Fallout New Vegas? I know it's in that movie. What's it called? Independence Day. Will Smith dragged an alien to Hell Central.
Favorite things about these online games, because there is, like, sort of like a wall or a barrier that you're having to, like, fight through in order to reach your audience, because they're scattered across the city, the country, the world, who knows. So that can be really, really difficult to deal with. And it's made me, like, have to really focus on watching people's faces, engage their reaction.
Well, any Zoom meeting should have taught humans that, right? I never used Zoom. Isn't there like a generation of people that grew up with Zoom? They should know. They should know. Unless they were on their phone doing Facebook instead of looking at people in Zoom, they should know. Cues, you know, facial cues, facial tics, you know, that kind of thing.
That way, as opposed to listening for it. So yeah, that's been difficult for me. And I think that just shows that there is just something so magical about being in person with people. You're really able.
Okay, so will a VTT fix this problem? Or is she talking about a VTT? I'm curious. Because VTTs, oftentimes the cameras are off. So how do you know if the person's even at the keyboard or not?
Well, to connect in ways that you just can't when you're separated physically. You know what I mean? Okay, major pro, and this is so, so huge. The various online apps and digital materials that are at your...
Uh-oh. Is she going to mention StreamYard? Because that's the go-to for this kind of stuff. StreamYard is meant for tabletop RPGs. All the VTTs out there that people are buying up, those are the, I don't know, you're being led astray with that stuff.
Your disposal when you play online are incredible and they are extremely immersive. You can have beautiful digital maps that are for very cheap or...
Okay, so immersive. Immersive. Pictures with squares, and then you put your pogs on the squares. Is that immersive? Is it really? Because now you're playing an MMO by hand when you're doing that kind of stuff.
Or free. 2-Minute Tabletop has... a bunch of different maps and assets and tokens that are free. You can also just pop on a Patreon and support an artist for like a couple of bucks and have access to an extensive library of beautiful maps. And that's fantastic. That already, when you drop...
Yeah, when games fold, you know, game companies, studios fold, they lay off everybody. All those content creators, guess what they do? They make content. That's what they do. They make content. It ends up in your VTT.
Drop that in front of your players. They see where they are. They feel like they're in that space. Also, these different online programs you can use to run these games, like Foundry or Roll20, have all these different sort of like effects and things at your disposal. Lighting effects, music and sound effects. Some of them have like weather effects that you can add in. And all of that is extremely immersive and makes it really hard to not feel like you're there in that scene. And that can be difficult to achieve in an in-person game. The really beautiful terrain.
In the 80s, I would go to this, my so-called friend's house. I only went to his house because he had a cool house. It was a 1950s postmodern international style home, one of a kind. It was a prototype home, very much like, The Incredibles, that kind of architecture. Anyway. I just liked going to his house because the house was amazing. But we were in some college courses together. And he was... he said he played D&D, but we would never get a D&D game started whenever I would go over there. So we would end up playing a board game of some sort. But anyway, he was real big on ambient sounds and... music theme stuff in the background while we're doing our games. Fancy record player with the... It was old. It was a phonograph. It was a quadraphonic setup. Not Pioneer. Not anything... You know, my parents had something like this. They got from the grandma. The grandmas all had these things. Phono players... You know, phonograph players inside of furniture? Like, what? Like, what? This looks like a place where you put your plates and forks and knives in. No, it's a phonograph. Those are speakers in that wooden cabinet there. What? No, I'm not going to help you pick that up and move it around somewhere. No. Once you put it down in the hallway or whatever, it's there for life. It has to be near an electrical outlet, though. But yeah, so my friend would have, he always had Victory at Sea. He would play Victory at Sea. I'm like, come on. Or if we were doing something else, he would have records from all the old 60s TV shows, movies, musicals, that kind of stuff. And then he got into the laser discs, I think, when the laser discs were coming out. So we'd have that going on in the background. But he always had to have music or something playing during our games. Every time. But it somehow matched whatever setting we were trying to do, or world building we were doing, or character generation we were doing. The music always seemed to fit well. So that was good. And that his house was awesome. The house is still there. I went by it the other day. And they haven't touched it. They haven't done anything to it. So that's good. Sometimes people buy a house not knowing what it's even for, and they tear it down and put something else there. But I guess the people who live there now understand what that house means.
Brain pieces and tokens that we often associate with these D&D games, like Dwarven Forge stuff, is expensive. Most people don't have the budget for that. I'll see Critical Role getting kind of like slammed for having all these fancy, expensive maps and stuff. And
that's weird. I mean, if they can afford it, what's the big deal? What's the other option? What's the McDonald's brand of that stuff? Is there one? It's like, I remember when I was a kid, I'd see, there was like the Lotus, there was the Ferrari, the Maseratis, Lamborghinis, but then they had the cheap imitation versions of those cars that people would drive around in. And people would tease him, look what he's driving. One of his homemade Erector set car that looks like a Lambro. They get teased. And I would say to the guy, dude, you don't even have a car. You don't even have a car. What are you worried about? What someone's driving or not? You know, these are people that count other people's money.
They're like, that's not realistic. And it's like, well, yeah, no. Most of us are probably rolling out the dry eraser gridded mat and drawing.
Drawing? Yeah, that's what I do. I got battle map. It's got square on one side, hex on the other side. It's just, you know, it's just beige. I guess, what is that? Light tan color with some brown texture to it. Nothing fancy. If I want greenery, if I want grass, I can draw grass. If I want brown driftwood, I can draw brown driftwood. If I want cement, I can draw gray. So it's a good color for a battle mat. And it wipes off. So used it once. And that was when I was doing my videos on using minis. I used to do videos on YouTube on how I use minis in role-playing games. Using minis with or without battle maps. You know, that kind of stuff. People watched them. But then that computer died. And then I had a better camera that didn't have the same kind of connection. So, and it was all over on the other side of the room there. On my my game table over there, which I don't think has ever been shown. on this channel. But anyway, I have a game table. And what was it? Something happened. Oh, I remember. Obama was elected. That's what happened. So that's when the beginning of the end started, was when Obama got elected second term.
Questionable drawings to draw out our map, and that's the best we can do. And sometimes we have tokens for our characters, and sometimes we're using dice or gummy bears or, you know, the random game pieces from the various board games you've got lying around. Yeah, it's not necessarily the most immersive thing in the world. It's way easier to kind of have all these high quality.
Okay, so for her, immersive is the quality of the materials used in the miniature replicas. And when I was a kid, we were arguing about lead or pewter. Pewter.
Bells and whistles to add to your game when it's just online, because you can get a lot of that for much cheaper. Whereas, like, getting these physical things, it's going to be more expensive. By far, the biggest con to online play is just not physically being with your friends. There are just certain things that come with being together with your D&D group that you just can't repeat when you're online. I was talking to my players about...
Well, that's the beginning. Well, that's the other part I was going to mention. The way things are in the world, the way Western society is now, yeah. You're better off just being alone than with a group of people, because the group of people are cancel culture for the most part. So find people online you can be friends with and just count your blessings. Because in real life, people will try to cancel your ass the minute they find out something about you.
About this today, and sort of asking them about the pros and cons that they felt were associated with online games. And most of us mentioned missing, like, snacking with each other. We used to always get Oreos and Goldfish, and we would sit and, like, munch on all of that while playing these games. I miss that. That's really, it's like annoying and frustrated to not have that anymore. Also, you know, my players are spread across 4 different time zones, and that can really limit how long we can play. We pretty much have to be done by like 10:30 p.m. because I've got people that are in different time zones, and for them it's later than that, and they need to go to bed because they've got work the next morning. So that can be difficult to work around. It sort of limits how long you can play. You know, little things like somebody is about to cast like a really big powerful spell and they need a bunch of dice, and they don't personally have enough dice, and so everybody around the table hands them all of their like d4s so that they can cast this like 8th level fireball and roll all the damage. You know, you don't get that when you're playing online, which is kind of sad. And even things almost unrelated to D&D. But I remember my group, you know, every once in a while we'd have some people that had to cancel last minute, or we needed more time.
Women like relationships. Guys, eh. They'll fight online. Guys will fight in person and online. It's no different.
Time to prep for the next session. And so we would just sort of hard pivot to something else, like, you know, playing Super Smash Brothers or Mario Party, or like pulling out a board game or something. And that's not really easy to do with online games unless you've prepped all of that ahead of time. So it's a little harder to like fast pivot to like some sort of last minute other thing. Things like that. There's just that sort of like, I don't know, that sort of personable kind of quality that you lack in a lot of ways with online games.
Yeah, but okay. She doesn't role play, she just board games. So I guess online is, it's like, oh, but I only have D&D assets for my online game. If you're a role player, all you need is a camera and microphone. That's it. And you can start role playing. Oh, so and so didn't show up? Okay. We can still role play, or we can do a different session, different setting, whatever, on the fly, whatever. Let's do it. Oh, he's joining us? Okay. Well, we'll just role play, and then he shows up or whatever. And you don't have to fuss with the board. No pieces. No stat prerequisites. But was he level 3? Do you know? In the last session, was he still at level 3? Was he at level 4 now? You know, that kind of stuff. Real role-playing sessions, you don't have to go into that nonsense. You just role-play. What breaks the role-play is when someone's camera or mic goes out. That's pretty much means it's over. It means, because, you know, it's unfortunate, but when your character dies in role play, you die in real life. Same with camera failure or mic failure. If your technology fails on you on your end, you die for the most part.
Games, and you can get really, really close. You really can, but there's always going to be just a little bit of something missing. And that's why I try to get my group together every summer so that we can be together in person and sort of relive some of those moments and stuff. And it's not easy to do. We've yet to all be in the same room at the same time. But even though I miss that personable nature, and even though online games do not compare, if it weren't for online D&D play, if it weren't for this ability to play online, I wouldn't get to play at all, which is crazy. I think for most of my group,
what the VTTs did was allow the unclean masses, the general public, as it were, the normies, to come online with all their junk games. Before that, before VTTs, for the most part, you had mostly role players. World of Darkness was doing the online gaming first. It was all roleplay. There were no D&D sessions played online. No one was using Google Hangouts to play D&D. What was a close third or fourth to D&D involving Dungeons and Dragons, but without being Dungeons and Dragons? What would it be? Maybe someone knows who's watching this. Back in 2012 with Google Hangouts, who was playing a fantasy? What was the fantasy role-playing game that people did online, if there was one? It was mostly role-play. Theater of the mind, as it were. Even though I hate that term. That's what they were saying. Theater of the mind. So when they would say theater of the mind, what they were really saying was, we're going to be playing World of Darkness. There were no VTTs. If there was anything, there was a die roller. That was about it. You could share a screen. That doesn't really count as a VTT, though. I can't think of a fantasy game right now. You know, a first-gen RPG, I can't think of one that people played online before there were VTTs. I blame D&D 4E for this VTT nonsense. And I blame World of Warcraft, too.
If we didn't have D&D, if we didn't have the ability to play it online, we would have really struggled to make it through the pandemic. That was sort of our lifeline for quite a while there. There were times when we were playing twice a week, every single week, and it was like the thing to look forward to in such a tough time for a lot of us. So, though in a few ways it is inferior, it's so wonderful that we even have the option to begin with. Anyway, I hope you found this video entertaining. If you did, please feel free to like and subscribe. That always...
Okay, I thought she was going to say something about not using... I don't know. She just kind of went both ways. I do both ways. Pros and cons of things. That's what her video's about, pros and cons. So there's like... We end where we began.